Praise the Lord. Thank God for the privilege of the opportunity. I just love that song that just closed out that section. I speak Jesus, and I just think it's so appropriate for what I'm going to share this morning. So I'm just grateful for that song. It has set really a good tone in my spirit and a confirmation for what God has placed upon my heart. So we're reading today from 1 Samuel chapter 17, verses 24 to 29. 1 Samuel 17, 24 to 29. I'm going to read. Before that, let me pray. God Almighty, this is the word that you place in my spirit. This is the word for this moment. Lord, your word is already truth. Lord, the entrance of your word giveth light. Give us, we who are simple, hungry, and thirsty for righteousness, understanding of what your spirit is saying to us. And we not only desire to hear, but we desire to do, Lord God. So as we receive the word today, thank you for what it will change in our hearts, what it will bring, how it will bring conviction, and how it will direct, Lord God, how we live and represent you in this earth. In Jesus' name, amen. 1 Samuel 17, 24 to 29 says, "And all the men of Israel, when they saw the man, fled from him and were so afraid. And the men of Israel said, Have ye seen this man that is come up? Surely to defy Israel is he come up, and it shall be that the man who killeth him, the king will enrich him with great riches and will give his daughter and make his father's house free in Israel. And David spake to the men that stood by him, saying, What shall be done to the man that killeth this Philistine and taketh away the reproach from Israel? For who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God? And the people answered him after this manner, saying, So shall it be done to the man that killeth him. And Eliab, his eldest brother, heard when he spake unto the men, and Eliab's anger was kindled against David. And he said, Why camest thou down hither? And with whom hast thou left those few sheep in the wilderness? I know thy pride and the naughtiness of thine heart, for thou art come down that thou mightest see the battle. Verse 29. And David said, What have I now done? Is there not a cause? So today the devotion is entitled Representation Over Reputation. Representation over reputation. John Wooden said, and I quote, Be more concerned with your character than your reputation. Because your character is what you really are, while your reputation is merely what others think you are. So let me explain this whole topic about representation over reputation as I heard the Holy Spirit speak to me. Christians today, and I'm including myself as Christians, we are concerned so much about how we look in people's eyes, what people think about us. We want people to speak well of us, to like us, to celebrate us. That's our reputation. Our reputation has become such a primary focus that in the world we live now, that is so hostile to God, hostile to Christianity, very secular, very perverted in its values, those who profess to be followers of Jesus don't want to mash anybody's toes, don't want to offend the majority, don't want to stand up for the truth of Scripture. Because we care more about how we look to men, that's our reputation, rather than standing up for Jesus, being examples, being light in the darkness, that is representation. Representing Christ in this secular world, we must expect that we will be rejected, criticized, mocked, accused, simply slighted because of our position in Jesus. It will offend many today in a world of humanistic that is humanistically viewed, that totally excludes God and excludes the Scripture. Don't be surprised that representing Jesus will bring you in collision with churchgoers who think that you're taking your Christian life too serious. Please let us soak in what I've just said, and may all of us who have an ear to hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying. So in the story I've read, David shows up on the battlefront where he hears the Philistine champion Goliath mocking the people of God. And Goliath was doing this for the last 40 days, morning and evening. When Israel heard Goliath speak, when they saw him, they were afraid and they fled. Now, right now, the world is making a mockery of us who are Christians. They are making a mockery of Christian morality, powerful media message images, and trying to direct a culture that is putting pressure on the church to conform to its standard of marriage and family life, to accept this new sexual revolution that is totally contrary to God, totally contrary to Scripture. those who are fueling and financing this evil agenda in the world. They're not satisfied to live their lives. They don't want to be equal with us. They want dominance. They want attention. They want control. They want to be the standard and the voice that all of us will obey and conform to. They are like Goliath. They're sending out threats to the church, mocking us and taunting us. We hold to the truth of God's word on marriage and family life. We who hold to that truth of God's standard are being called bigots and homophobics, and we are being accused of trying to impose our religious views on others. The pressure is mounting, and Christians are crumbling. Orthodox churches are bowing and bending to the secularists, and our representation of Christ in this world is very conflicting and confusing. The voice of the giants are speaking so loudly. They are telling us either we submit or we be silenced. So let's learn a few lessons from David that will teach us how to focus more on our representation of Jesus in this world rather than our reputation. Listen to me. It should matter to us more what God thinks about us than what people think about us. In Acts 5 and 29, when the council had forbidden Peter and the other apostles of speaking in the name of Jesus, Peter said boldly, "We ought to obey God rather than man." Christians, we have to decide whose agenda we are going to support, whether it's God's agenda or man's agenda, whether it's Christ's agenda or the world's agenda. The moment David showed up on that battlefront, he knew who he was representing. In verse 26 of the text, 1 Kings 17, it teaches us the first principle about representation. David says, "Who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God?" Number one, we must know our identity. Settle in your mind and by your convictions, by your lifestyle, whose side you are fighting on. We who are representing Christ on this earth, there are only two persons in this earth, two categories of persons in this earth. You're either serving the Lord or you're serving Satan. You're either on God's side or you're on Satan's side. And this is what David was actually saying by his position. David recognized that the Philistine was an enemy of Israel, who had no covenant with the Lord, who did not know the God that he knew. And as a follower of Jesus, we have to know and identify the enemies of the cross and recognize their agenda. We have to recognize the language, the philosophies, the ideas, and the subtle ways in which the world is trying to corrupt the truth of God's word. We cannot allow the ungodly and the unbelievers to tell us what is truth. John 14:6, Jesus has already declared, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me." In John 17:17, Jesus said, "Sanctify them with thy truth. Thy word is truth." So the word has already declared that Jesus is the truth and the scripture is the truth. The world is getting darker every second. And as the people of God, we need to get refueled. We need to get reconnected. We need to stand on our convictions. We need to be solidly grounded in the word of God. We need to know whether we are going to be holy for God or whether we are going to shine as the light of the world. In Ephesians 5:8, it says, "You who were once darkness are now called as light in the Lord." It says, "Walk as children of light." In 1 Peter 2:9, it says, "You are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, that you should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light." Matthew 5:16 says, "Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven." We are called to represent God in this world. God's glory must be our priority, not pleasing the world. We are not to be conformed to the world. We are to be transformers and transmitters of light to this world. Philippians 2:7, it gives us the greatest model of what it means to care less about our reputation. It says, in speaking about Jesus, he made himself of no reputation, took upon himself the form of a bondservant, and came in the likeness of men. Jesus set aside his heavenly honor and glory to become like us mere human beings. He humbled himself We do everything to build a reputation today, to want to look good in people's eyes. But Jesus shelved this. He thought more about pleasing God rather than his own name. That is what representation is. Forgetting about me. Forgetting about how people perceive me and how I can please God instead of pleasing men. Secondly, so the first thing is know your identity. Secondly, to truly represent Christ in this earth, expect that you will have rejection. In 1 Samuel 17:28, David's elder brother Eliab, who was among the faithful, hiding, doing nothing, he came at the moment he heard David speaking. He came and he confronted David. He said to David, he said, "You're prideful and haughty." And he sought to humiliate David and talking to him about, "What have you done about those little sheep in the wilderness?" Expect to be rejected in this world as we are going to be representing Jesus. You would think that all Christians would have had the same standard. And when it comes to same-sex marriage, holiness, chastity, immorality, you would think that all of us who believe in Jesus would have the same standard. But no, every day we are being shocked into unbelief, into disbelief, as we realize how many Christians are falling on the side of the world, how many Christians are bowing to the systems of secularism and humanistic views. We are seeing how many people are afraid and ashamed to stand up for Jesus, who rather the praise of men rather than the praise of God. When we care more about our reputation, we want to be nice, welcoming, accommodating. We want to be accepted. We want people to speak well of us. But listen to me, let us stop playing the fool with the grace of God. Let us stop playing the fool with representing Jesus. God has called us to stand up for righteousness. He has called us to stand up for what is the truth. We've got to cut off the head of the Goliath spirit that is pervading the world today, that is in the church, that is calling us to compromise. I call us to be like David, not to be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, and to stand up upon the rock, which is Jesus Christ. When we speak of representation, we also have to think of Daniel. I don't even know if I'm going too long. We have to think of Daniel when he was offered the king's food. Daniel didn't even care what others were eating. He said he will have none of it. The scripture said he purposed in his heart he would not defile himself with the king's food. It didn't matter to him whether he looked stupid or whether he looked weak. His reputation was not important to him. He feared God more. He wanted to represent his God even though he was in a foreign territory. What was at stake here is that it was about who Daniel was worshiping. Eating the king's food meant that Daniel was saying, "We are one. We share the same values." But by Daniel refusing to eat the king's meat and the wine, he was declaring, "I am not a son of your kingdom. I may be serving in your kingdom, but I am not a son of your kingdom." This is exactly who the follower of Christ is in this pagan-driven world, this anti-God culture that we are living in. We are in the world, but we are not of the world. There are moments when society wants to hand us what to believe, what to think, what are true values, what is right and what is wrong, how to behave, how to think. But we, like Daniel, have to refuse the king's meat. We cannot sit down. We cannot dine with the world in their beliefs and practices that are hostile to scripture, that reject the truth and the authority of the word of God, that reject the reverence of God or the existence of God. We as the children of God have to recognize what kind of diet we are going to consume. We must not allow the ways of the world to invade and permeate our lives. Like Daniel, we have to let the systems of the practices of the world that oppose the truth of the scripture, we have to let them know, "I'm not sitting down with you. I'm not dining with you. I'm not a part of the kingdom of darkness. I'm a part of the kingdom of light." And don't misunderstand me. I believe what Jesus said in John 3:17, that he did not come to condemn the world, but that the world through him will be saved. We are not condemning the world and its practices. We are just saying we are not compromising for the Lord. We are going to represent God. Listen to me, the people of God who are watching and who will listen after. Just as Nebuchadnezzar was offering those Jewish boys his food, which has possibly been offered to his gods, Satan is offering us as God's people his meat. What to think? He's telling us how he wants to weaken our convictions. He wants to steer us away from our spiritual identity. And if it's ever a time we need to stand up for Jesus, it is now. Amen. We must be able to identify in our culture what is the king's meat, what is the world's food, any belief, any way of living, thinking, any songs, activities, any entertainment, music, literature, language, anything that is sponsored by the devil, it is king's meat. We will have no part of it. We will not sit down with them. We will not participate in the things that oppose God. Jesus has sent us in this world to represent him. Blessed is the man, Psalm 1 says, who does not sit in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stand in the way of sinners, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. We must be solidly grounded. We must settle in our mind. We must not be driven away by philosophies and ideologies of this society that we live in, that wants to eradicate the truth of scripture from our lives. Finally, to live in this world, to represent Jesus, we must represent him in this world. We must be able to see the cause. We must see the cause, that there is a cause for us to stand up and represent Jesus. Very quickly, I'm coming to an end right now. We are living in a culture where Christianity is being remade to blend into a secularized culture where we are being asked to bow the knee to the ungodly agenda, to conform our thinking and beliefs to this world. What is right is now called wrong, and what is wrong is called right. The radicals know how to make themselves look good and how to make us as Christians look bad. It is in this culture God is calling us to stand up courageously, my brothers and sisters, like David against the giants that are seeking to force us into hiding, that are seeking to silence our voice. We are truly in a battle, and it is a spiritual battle, a battle for the future of your children and my grandchildren, a battle for the voice of truth, a battle to represent Christ in this world without compromise. Who will be like David? I call myself, as I call you who are watching today. Will you stand up for Christ in spite of the mockery, in spite of the humiliation, in spite of knowing that you can be rejected? Will you stand up for Jesus? This is what the Spirit of the Lord is saying. Let us represent him in the world. Let us have representation over reputation. Don't care how you look in the eyes of people. Stand up for what is the truth. Stand up for Jesus. Can you hear the Goliath speaking? Can you see them mocking you? Can you see them mocking Jesus? And the question today is, will you stand up or will you shut up? Father God, in the name of Jesus, give us the conviction, Lord, that there is a cause for us to stand up for you in this world. There's a reason to be a light in the midst of the darkness. There's a reason to let the world know that Jesus is the only way. He's the only truth, and he's the only life. There is a reason for us to speak that name, Jesus, that is higher than every other name. Oh God, place within every one of us as believers the conviction to be a difference to this world, to shine as lights in the midst of the crookedness and the darkness in this world, to represent you, Lord. You are counting on us, Holy Ghost. You are counting on us. You place your spirit in us. You have placed your power in us. You have placed your image in us, Holy Ghost. You have given us promises, Lord God, that we can know that we are not alone in this world. Teach us not to bow to the spirits of Goliath. Like David, make us to be bold and fearless, to stand up for the truth and to stand up for righteousness. May we never compromise. May the spirit of compromise never allow us to bow, but may we stand up fearlessly and courageously, that, Lord, we will be a light for you, God, in the midst of this darkness. Thank you for the privilege to speak your word, and may those of us who have heard, may we also do your word. In the name of Jesus, I pray and bless you in Jesus' name. Amen.